looking back. Looking forward. Looking down. Looking up. Looking around. Journey of exploration to the distant past, to the frontiers of tomorrow, from the infinitely small to the infinitely large, the mysterious, the mundane. Come, let us travel to the horizons of knowledge. This program has been made possible thanks to a generous grant from Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, Vodafone Egypt Foundation, the OPEC Fund for International Development, and the Carnegie Corporation of New York.
Flight. Birds in flight. From all these times, human beings have looked at birds flying and dreamt of one day being able to soar into the air. And that dream has captured the imagination of human beings from all times. In ancient Greek myths, Icarus and his son Daedalus flew with wings affixed with wax, but came too close to the sun, and Icarus fell and died. The dream continued, and others tried, including Abbas ibn Firnas, who in the Middle Ages jumped off a tall minaret, hoping to fly with a contraption of his own. He did not succeed, but he survived and continued to do other great things. And so it has been that humans have continued this dream of flight until finally they abandoned the idea of exactly copying the birds flapping their wings. And they latched on to different models, and from balloons to fixed-wing aircrafts to helicopters, the story of flight took off. This is the story of aviation. The great Renaissance master Leonardo da Vinci put it most eloquently. When once you have tasted flight, you will forever walk the earth with your eyes turned skyward. For there you have been, and there you will always long to return. Indeed, Abbas ibn Firnas in the Middle Ages tried to fly by jumping off tall minaret. He did not succeed, and he survived to do many other discoveries. By the 18th century, the brothers Montgolfier were able to fly with a hot air balloon. And ballooning became established in the 19th century. Balloons were to be used for the transport of people across the Atlantic, by a number of companies into the 20th century. But the huge disaster of the Hindenburg in 1938 brought the end of the Zeppelin era. Balloons continue to exist today, mostly for entertainment and touristic leisure activities.
But the dream of more maneuverable flying machines continued in the 20th century when flying with engine-propelled, heavier-than-air machines would become synonymous with the century. Others had tried, including the Secretary of the Smithsonian at the time.
Is the Langley Aerodrome, which Samuel Langley, the Secretary of the Smithsonian in 1903, was racing against the Wright brothers to be the first to fly.
But lacking the design insights of the Wright brothers, his design, seen here, did not succeed in flying. Nevertheless, the plane is indeed impressive. Now, this just shows how intensive the competition was when on the 17th of December 1903, the Wright brothers finally succeeded. Though the length of their first flight was shorter than the wingspan of a modern Boeing 747, the age of aviation had begun. Here I am in the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C., and this is the Wright Brothers Flyer.
In 1903, on December 17th, Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, Wilbur and Orville Wright, bicycle makers, actually flew for the first time a heavier-than-air aircraft powered by an engine. This is the Wright Flyer. They opened the era of flight.
هم اللي كان عندهم فلوس ولا كان عندهم كذا راي يا شيء انما جدعان قالوا يلا يلا نروح نشوف القصه دي ويجربوها وتنجح وينقلوا تاريخ البشريه الى مرحله جديده.
The Wright brothers succeeded where others failed. Why? Well, for one thing, they really understood the scientific concept behind the plane. They tested the way the propeller should function. And they were savvy makers of machinery. In an amazing spurt of creativity, humanity would build on these modest beginnings and put a man on the moon in less than a lifetime, in only 66 years. After them, new records were set, new milestones were passed. Blériot crossed the channel in 1907. Santos Dumont invented the wristwatch with his friend Cartier. 1909 was the first military plane. And the First World War was the first conflict where aviation played a part.
كان زمان في الحرب العالمية الأولى كان يعني الشغل الطيارة في الحرب إيه إنه الراجل الطيار كان بياخد شوية أنابل وبرميها كده بس كده فين الجيش اللي تحته وبرميها.
After the war, the barnstormers took over. But the next great moment for humanity was the crossing of the Atlantic. This is the spirit of St. Louis, the plane that that Charles Lindbergh would fly alone from New York to Le Bourget in Paris. In 1927, he even blocked the front window to have more fuel, and he would simply have to lean out of the window to see where he was going. It represented the peak of technology, an impossible dream.
He made it. Charles A. Lindbergh landed at Le Bourget Airport, Paris at 5:24 this afternoon.
Delirium. The lone eagle had succeeded.
For Lindbergh flew for a prize. It's competition and also the sponsorships that people were willing to provide to excite the developers and to give them a way to actually afford what they were trying to do.
Amelia Earhart, a pioneering woman pilot, took off into the sky.
I believe that women have as much courage as men.
Thereafter, the story of flight is less one of individual heroes, but of concerted efforts. Corporations and governments take the lead in building the successive generations of aircraft. And here are some of the major planes of the 1930s, including that old warhorse, the DC-3. By World War II, aircraft would be decisive. They played a major role in defending Britain from German invasion in 1940-41, and they would be decisive in winning the war in the Pacific as Navy pilots from the top of aircraft carriers would be the spearhead of naval warfare from Pearl Harbor to Midway. Ultimately, this particular plane would have a very special place in history. This is the Enola Gay.
I'm standing here at the Udvar-Hazy Center of the Air and Space Museum of Washington, D.C., part of the Smithsonian Institution. And I'm standing in front of one of the most important airplanes in history. This is the Enola Gay, a bomber that was used by Paul Tibbets and his crew to drop the atom bomb on Hiroshima on the 6th of August, 1945. The Enola Gay on that flight started the age of atomic warfare.
Let there be no mistake. We shall completely destroy Japan's power to make war.
And suddenly I saw a light, like magnesium light, flashlight.
And the end is not yet. And looking down from thousands of feet, all I can think of,
my God, what have we done?
The devastation of the atomic bombs was enormous. Between 150 to 250,000 people died, about 160 of them instantaneously by the explosions, and the others by burns, radiation sickness, flash burns, and other injuries. Luckily for humanity, never again would atomic bombs be dropped on human beings.
There are a number of airplanes like the Enola Gay, which was a B-29. And at the time that it flew its important mission, it was the most technologically advanced airplane in the world.
Although we tend to think of military and civilian aviation as separate, in fact, they do intersect. Next to me here is the Boeing 707 testbed, of which about 850 were sold to the military as transport planes, but also it became the 707, the earliest and most successful commercial airliner that was a jet. True, the British had the Comet before it, but the Boeing 707 was the marker of the real commercial age of aviation in jets.
Jet aircraft, which appeared at the end of the Second World War, would become the next great phase of aviation. And this particular prototype would be decisive. It is the cargo version of what would become the Boeing 707, the first truly widespread jet in commercial aviation.
This is it, the first American commercial jet capable of economical transatlantic service, the Boeing 707 Jet Clipper, much higher and faster than you've ever flown before. Jet speeds will help to accomplish one of man's long-sought goals, an easy interchange of peoples throughout the world. Transoceanic flights now become short hops. 6.5 magic hours to Europe.
A completely different orientation was taken by a number of pioneers, which were to develop not the conventional fixed-wing planes, but helicopters. These were vertical liftoff and landing planes that could hover in the air with a horizontal propeller of large magnitude and a directional propeller on the tail.
Turn port 180.
As planes flew ever faster and higher, they seemed to hit a barrier when they approached the speed of sound, 1,236 kilometers per hour. Many test pilots died trying to cross that barrier.
In 1954, pilot Chuck Yeager succeeded, and this tiny little aircraft is the plane he used to break the sound barrier.
تشاك ييجر ده شخصية ظريفة جدا لما بتكلمه تلاقيه راجل غريب جدا في 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 شخصيته عادي خالص بسيط للغاية ما هوش فاكر نفسه إنه هو عمل يعني حاجة كبيرة يقول لك نوم إحنا كلنا كنا مع أنا كنت مع شوية شباب كنا ستة سبعة كنا بنعملها أي واحد فينا كان يعملها يعني مش أنا ما عملش عملة كبيرة
الله
وراح معديها وزود عليها شوية يعني مش بس قال لك أنا عايز أعدي سرعة السرعة دي وأسكت فراح مزود عليها كمان عشان يثبت إنه لسه حاجة وعرف إن هي بعد مدة الطيارة ابتدت تتهز جامد وابتدى يقول إن هنا لو زودت زيادة عن كده هتتشتش لأن التركيبة بتاعت الطيارة نفسها كانت معمولة على هذا الأساس فهو هدى شوية ونزل على أساس إن هو يجيب لهم المعلومة دي عشان يعملوا الطيارة اللي تعدي أكثر من كده إزاي كان عايز يوريهم نفسه بس عظمة
The sound barrier would be exceeded many times in military aviation but not in commercial aviation except for the Anglo-French Concorde.
An elegant plane that fell victim to economics more than the relentless march of technology. But what was the greatest plane ever built? Probably that honor should go to the Lockheed SR-71.
Behind me is the SR-71, arguably the most successful aircraft in history. It still holds the altitude records and the speed records for surveillance aircraft. Built by Lockheed, was retired in 1990, has had a major career as the Blackbird.
The Lockheed SR-71 could fly at over 3 times the speed of sound and could reach over 70,000 feet high. It flew faster and higher than any other plane ever built. It was a reconnaissance plane used by the United States to spy on the Soviet Union at the height of the Cold War. It was retired in 1992 without a single plane having ever been shot down. The SR-71 has inspired many fantasies, including most recently an appearance in the film Transformers 2.
No plane has flown higher or faster than the SR-71.
But then the story of aviation starts becoming interwoven with the story of rockets and satellites and the space age. Rockets, capsules, and satellites are the vehicles of the space age. New pioneers are taking us where no human has ever been before. It's an exciting time to be alive. For wherever you turn, science is opening new doors. Technology is offering new opportunities, and humans are pressing forward to meet new challenges. It is an exciting story, but it is a story for another day. I am Ismail Serageldin, thanking you for having watched this program of Horizons.